Welcome to Echoing Faith Today, a podcast conversation on themes of impact and relevance in the new Directory for Catechesis from the Pontifical Council for the Promotion of the New Evangelization. I'm Dr. Jem Sullivan, host and faculty in the School of Theology and Religious Studies at the Catholic University of America. On this podcast, we'll hear from scholars, experts, and those in pastoral ministry. So welcome back, and thank you for taking your place at this table of conversation. In this week's podcast, it is my privilege to welcome His Excellency Archbishop Rino Fisichella, President of the Pontifical Council for the Promotion of the New Evangelization. Archbishop Fisichella taught fundamental theology for 20 years at the Pontifical Gregorian University and served as rector of the Pontifical Lateran University. In 2010, Pope Benedict XVI appointed him as the first president of the Pontifical Council for the Promotion of the New Evangelization. And in 2013, he was appointed president of the International Council for Catechesis. This past June, Archbishop Fisichella presented the Directory for Catechesis to the Universal Church at a press conference at the Vatican. Archbishop Fisichella joins us now from Rome to discuss the new Directory for Catechesis. Good afternoon, Your Excellency. Thank you so much for joining us today. Welcome to the podcast. I'm so grateful for your time, and I'm looking forward to your observations on the Directory for Catechesis from the Pontifical Council for the Promotion of the New Evangelization. Thank you so much for joining us from Rome.
Thank you for inviting me at this podcast. I'm very happy, and my best greetings to all we are following this podcast.
Thank you. Your Excellency, this long-awaited Directory for Catechesis has 12 chapters divided into three parts. Today we focus on major themes, but first a general question. At the press conference to present the Directory for Catechesis, you noted that the publication of a directory is a joyful event in the life of the church. How is the publication of this directory a moment of joyful hope for the church today?
Well, I will say is an event of joy because it shows how dynamic is the catechesis and the life of the church. Catechesis cannot be static. Catechesis should be a very dynamic event for the life of the church. We should remember a beautiful expression in Lumen Gentium, in the Constitution for the Church, where the fathers at that time wrote that Ecclesia semper reformanda. That means the Church needs a development. Now, the Directory is in this process, and should be understood, first of all, in this process of development. There is, of course, a continuity. We had until today, this is the third directory. We have a continuity, but a continuity in a development of catechesis. Because catechesis is not a side of the life of the church, but belongs to the heart, to the center of the Christian life.
Speaking of continuity, you know, there's continuity and innovation that marks this catechetical directory, as you said, the third of its kind since the Second Vatican Council. In presenting the text, you offered theological, ecclesial, and cultural reasons for a new directory. What are the distinct needs of the church today that gave birth to this directory?
Now, I will say that we should consider two main points in order to understand the reduction and also the originality of our directory. First of all, I will say is a cultural context. And the second point will be the life of the church in the last 20 years. If you allow me, I would like first of all to keep the first point, because I think it's very important, especially for the future and for the new generations, and in order also to catch the originality of the directory. We are in front of a very, very big challenge. And this is the digital culture. Normally, we don't think about it. We use it as an instrument, and we forget that behind the instruments, we have a very original and powerful culture. In the difference from the past time, where culture was more in a context, in a regional context, I mean, we should understand, for instance, the American context, Latin American context, European context, Italian, France, German context. Culture was really in a clear understanding, because it was in a specific context in the different cultures that we have. The digital culture is the fruit of globalization. That means that culture is no more limited to some countries, but belongs to the world as such. And that is a very big challenge, because asked to us, to all of us, especially to the church, to have a new language, a language that will be comprehensible for everybody. In this new language, there is also a synthetic language. This is no more the time for a metaphysical reflection, unfortunately, I would like to say, but we need to take the context as such. So we need to speak with our people in a very simple way, in a very synthetical way, and also knowing that once that you speak to someone like what we are doing, we are speaking to the world. Now, this is a first moment. And we cannot also forget that the digital culture with a new language impose new behaviors. And we are in front of new behaviors. And we have the second moment. The second moment is more ecclesial, because we cannot forget in the last 20 years, the progress, the novelty that we had, for instance, with the synod. I would like just to remember the synod on the word of God, the synod on new evangelization, the synod on family, the synod for youth, yes, and also the last one, the synod for Amazon. Synod for Amazon, it means essentially to enter in a cultural context. So if you take these five synods of the last 20 years, and if you put especially the teaching of Pope Francis with his programmatic exhortation, apostolic exhortation, Evangelii Gaudium, at the end of the synod of new evangelization, you can see that we have a very, very important context for catechesis.
Thank you, Your Excellency, for giving us the cultural context as well as the historical context that really helps us to locate this directory in that context. Evangelization occupies a primary place in the life of the church and in the everyday teaching of Pope Francis, as you have noted. And the vision of Pope Francis stands in continuity with Pope Benedict XVI, Pope John Paul II, and Pope Paul VI. How does this directory embody, in a particular way, the teaching of Pope Francis on the primacy of the evangelizing mission of the church and charismatic catechesis within it?
Well, thank you for this question, because it is very important in order to understand also the development and the redaction of the directory. Sure, we can say that the new directory for catechesis has as a focus, what Pope Francis called in his exhortation, Evangelii Gaudium, the charismatic catechesis. What does it mean, charismatic catechesis? I would say nothing else that catechesis should follow the characteristic of the evangelization, and not the contrary. Catechesis cannot be an instrumental use of evangelization. Now, we should be very, very clear on this point, because it seems to me that often we had a kind of instrumentalization of the point, the fundamental mission of the church, which is the evangelization. Paul VI wrote in Evangelii Nuntiandi, the church exists for evangelization. Now, this should be the goal of every catechesis and the all mission of the church itself. Now, there is a very amazing continuity between Evangelii Nuntiandi and Evangelii Gaudium under this aspect of the evangelization, and is what we call charismatic catechesis. That means essentially few points I would like to remember. First of all, what we are used to call the first announcement of Jesus Christ. Remembering that first announcing of Jesus Christ doesn't mean an announcement first because he is under temporality, but is the essential constitution of the church to announce in every moment Jesus Christ. That means for catechesis, for instance, that we cannot just in the first moment of catechesis announce Jesus Christ, and then we don't do the same following all the steps and the different moments of catechesis. No. The first announcement is a qualitative importance for the evangelization. We don't announce ourselves. We are announcing Jesus Christ, and that should be valid for kind, for baby, for youth, for adult people. It is for everybody, because in every stage of our life, we have an encounter with Jesus Christ. I would say that under this possibility to understand the first announcement, we should also remember a chapter, in my humble opinion, very important for the catechesis in the new directory, the sources of catechesis. The sources of catechesis are important because in our announcing, we can have a reflection of this continuity from the past, the present, and the future, and we can also take with us all the richness of our history. I think, for instance, but if I have time, I would like to return on this point, the way of beauty, because this is a very, very important moment for the charismatic catechesis.
Thank you so much, Your Excellency. Just, you know, also this qualitative understanding of charismatic catechesis really requires a paradigm shift. We have to change our understanding of, it's sort of like a drop of ink in a glass of water. The whole water becomes blue. It's not just one moment, but it's really kind of a field encompassing. In science, they talk about field encompassing. Everything is changed in light of that that announcement that you talked about. So thank you for recovering this. I'm thinking also of Joseph Jungmann, you know, almost 100 years ago, who would talk about this sense of the recovery of the kerygma from his work.
Absolutely. And speaking on Newman, let me say something more on that. Following Newman, 2 points I will say. The first one is in the end of his apologia for his life. So when Newman wrote the event of Christ cannot be an event of the past. Sure, he wrote, belongs to the past because it was 2,000 years ago, but is an event for the present, is an event for my history, is an event that continues to speak with me. And I think that this is also the goal for our catechesis. One of the tasks of the catechesis should be that we are not presenting something of the past. We are presenting an event of our present, of our own personal history. And the second is the expression very known of the holy Newman, cor ad cor loquitur, the heart speaks to another heart. And I think that this is another important point for our catechesis, and is also very clear done in the directory. This is an interpersonal encounter. If the goal of catechesis is to encounter Christ, if the task of catechesis following the evangelization is the first announcement of Jesus Christ, we cannot forget that we should bring people, everybody, each person, to a personal encounter with Jesus Christ. Catechesis cannot be something theoretical. Catechesis belongs to our daily life. Catechesis is to understand who we are and where we are going and which kind of witness we are giving to the world of today. And for the catechist, very important should be the interpersonal encounter with each single person.
Thank you so much, Archbishop. So good to hear your very clear explanation of what charismatic catechesis is really about and then the history of it. This leads us into the question of the intersection of liturgy and catechesis, the sense of the present, the here and now. The theme of mystagogy is discussed in the preface, in the introduction, and throughout the directory. Mystagogy engages this renewed appreciation of the liturgical signs of Christian initiation and supports this maturation of the unfolding process of within the Christian community. So why is mystagogy a privileged and obligatory path for catechesis today?
Thank you for this question, because mystagogy is a very important section, is throughout all the directory. I would like to say that why is important this section of mystagogy in the directory and in the catechesis, underline the importance of mystery. I hope that all catechists, they will understand in the right sense what I am saying, because normally when we cannot explain something, our conclusion is a mystery. This is not the way for the Christian life and for catechesis, and especially for the charismatic catechesis. The word, and of course the reality, the word of mystery should be put on the beginning of our announcement, of the beginning of our catechesis, not at the end. Because for us, mystery, it is not something that we cannot understand. This is not the biblical conception of mystery. Mystery is something that is revealed to us. And so we are in front of the mystery, and we know what the mystery is, because it's the person of Jesus Christ in our life. The mystery is God speaking with us, is God remaining with us. And this is, in my opinion, essentially for not only for catechesis, but for the life of the church, for theology, for catechesis, for our witness. We are witness of a mystery. Now, since the mystery and the comprehension of mystery is given, like St. Paul at the end to his letter of the Romans, is Christ in us, a mystery hidden but now revealed to us, Christ in ourselves. The church, the life of the church, has a special moment in order not only to understand the mystery, but also to celebrate the mystery. This is the moment of the mystagogy for catechesis. It means that two essential points. First of all, the language and signs, the liturgical language and the liturgical signs. We should be able to rediscover, to discover again, the signs and the language of liturgy, because in this way we can enter step by step in the deepest of the mystery that we celebrate and of which we are witness in the world. And second moment is the catechumenate. We cannot forget that the mystagogy is present essentially for the catechumenate. The source of mystagogy comes with the catechumenate. But catechumenate, it means also the announcement of conversion. The metanoia, the conversion, it means that everybody in front of Christ, in front of a personal encounter with him, our life should change. I cannot be neutral before Christ. Cannot, because it means that this is not a personal encounter. In my encounter, personal encounter with Christ, I change my life. I discover a new life.
Thank you, Your Excellency. You know, the sense that the mystery is revealed, and then it calls forth our participation. And that's the whole celebration of the sacraments, is our participation in the mystery of what God has revealed. The directory introduces several new, fresh themes and new directions. The primacy of the kerygma, you've talked about that. The dynamic process of evangelization and catechesis within it. Catechesis in a global, digitalized culture. The bioethical issues that impact catechesis, and then the way of beauty that you already spoke about. And then catechesis that accompanies with mercy the poor, people with disabilities, migrants, and prisoners. Share with our audience the importance of these new directions for in the directory for catechesis today.
Well, Jane, I would say that you mentioned some of these specific context of catechesis. I would like also to remember catechesis for and within families, our families, that a very important moment. Catechesis in a scientific context, catechesis in an ecumenical dialogue. So we have several parts in which catechesis should be engaged. Our goal it was to show that, as I mentioned before, catechesis cannot be something rhetorical and nor theoretical, but catechesis, it takes the daily life of each Christians. And for this reason, we should be challenged also by the challenge that we find daily in the streets of our city, immigrants, poor, everybody. If I think in a context like US, how many challenges you have today in order to understand the richness of our witness and the different possibilities that are given to us in order to understand how to be a coherent witness of the gospel in this world. And for this reason, we say the condition of disability. This dicastery, I confess, is very sensible on the topic because they are important for the life of the church, and they should have not only a peculiar catechesis, but we wrote in the directory also person with disabilities, they are called to be catechists and not just to receive a catechesis, but to be active and to be capable, to be ministry of this peculiar moment for the life of the church.
And that's a beautiful thing to see when that happens, when the members of the community of persons with disabilities actually become the ones who are handing on and witnessing to the faith. It's a beautiful moment for them, for that. One final question, Your Excellency. As president of the Pontifical Council for the Promotion of the New Evangelization, what are your hopes and your expectations for the implementation of the Directory for Catechesis across the Universal Church?
Well, Jim, let me say that we are very happy at this moment because in a few months and with the difficulties that we have around all the world for the COVID, at this moment we are already at the 10th translation of the directory. And that it means for us something unexpected because we didn't know that the interest for the directory was so immediately direct and immediately capable to be received. But I would say that we would like really that the catechesis starting from the new directory should be also free. I would say make free the catechesis from the unnecessary restrictions. Just an example. We cannot think on catechesis like the school. And also in our language, we should go over in our language. If you check the catechesis for a child in this moment, you can see that there is a book in the school and you have a book for catechesis. You have the room and you have the room for catechesis. You have the calendar and the diary, and then you have, we should go over on that, because catechesis is not a school. Catechesis is not an hour of catechesis. Catechesis is not a class of catechesis. No, is an encounter with Christ and is an encounter with our community. And this is the most important. There is a second restrictions in my mind. And we make catechesis because we need to receive a sacrament. It doesn't continue in this way. This is a very old understanding of catechesis. We don't have a catechesis because we need to receive baptism, first communion, confirmation, and so on. No, this is not the nature of catechesis. This is not the history of catechesis. Catechesis is to understand better my life as a Christian. Is to grow up in my identity, personal and Christian identity. This is the nature of catechesis.
We are so grateful for your presence with us today, Archbishop. I know our podcast audience will have gained a deeper appreciation of the Directory for Catechesis from the many insights and the prophetic call that you have given us today. Be assured of our prayers for you and the work of the Pontifical Council for the promotion of the new evangelization. And once again, we thank you very much. Please, we could end with a blessing from you, please.
With pleasure. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. For intercession of Our Lady, may our Lord give all of you his blessing. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you for joining in this podcast conversation with Archbishop Rino Fisichella. I hope it has deepened your understanding of the vision and the major themes of the Directory for Catechesis. We'll continue this conversation in the next podcast. So till then, keep the faith and keep echoing the faith. I'm Dr. Jem Sullivan. I hope you have a blessed day.